Welcome to Meddy Simplified. Today we are going to discuss another topic from ENT called as secretory otitis media. What is secretory otitis media? It is insidious condition. It is an insidious condition. What does insidious mean? It means a slow growing but harmful. So it is a slow growing harmful condition characterized by non-purulent effusion in the middle ear cleft. So what is secretory otitis media? It is an insidious condition characterized by non-purulent effusion in the middle ear cleft. Like, suppose, okay, before this, let's discuss something very funny about this disease, that this disease has many names. So along with all its symptoms, signs, we need to remember the different names of the same disease. It is also called as serous otitis media. Secretory otitis media is also called as serous otitis media. Another name for it is otitis media with effusion. Another name used for the same disease is mucoid otitis media. And the last is glue ear. So these are the four different names of the same disease. That is secretory otitis media, also called as serous otitis media with effusion, mucoid otitis media or glue ear. So what is secretory otitis media? It is an insidious condition characterized by non-purulent effusion in the middle ear cleft. So now let's discuss about something more about this disease. It is commonly seen in school going children, and most common it is seen in children of 2 to 6 years of age. And the fluid in this disease is generally sterile. So fluid is nearly sterile. So suppose this is our external ear. Here we have tympanic membrane. This is the middle ear cleft, middle ear with all those three ossicles. And we have a eustachian tube here which is connected to the nasopharynx, and at the end here we have the internal ear. So what is happening in secretory otitis media? Let's discuss the pathogen. This is the ear. Suppose this is the ear. This is external ear, middle ear and internal ear. In middle ear we have this eustachian tube and the middle ear cleft. It is formed by a mucus line. So this is what I want to focus on. So let's discuss about the pathology or the pathogenesis of the disease. How does this disease occur? It occurs only due to two conditions. Suppose the first is malfunctioning of eustachian tube. That is, the eustachian tube has two main functions. First is, it drains out the fluid from this middle ear cleft normally, and second thing what it does is it maintains the air pressure in the middle ear with the body. So the malfunctioning of eustachian tube, that is, it is not able to drain the fluid is eustachian tube is not able to ventilate middle ear. And it is not able to drain the fluid. First condition, that is malfunctioning of eustachian tube. Second is increased secretion of middle ear mucosa. The mucosa, that is this lining of the middle ear, has secretory function. So, increase in the secretory function of middle ear mucosa also may cause, may lead to secretory otitis media. So, what are the causes which leads to these two conditions in the middle ear? So, let's discuss the causes now. The causes. Before going to causes, once again, secretory otitis media is a non-purulent effusion in the middle ear cleft, and it occurs due to two conditions, that is malfunctioning of eustachian tube and increased secretion of middle ear mucosa. So what are the causes which leads to these two conditions? First we'll discuss the malfunctioning of eustachian tube. It is due to first adenoid hyperplasia is most common cause of secretory otitis media in children. So adenoid hyperplasia. Second, it can be due to any chronic sinusitis, chronic rhinitis or tonsillitis. What happens in this condition? All these three conditions, what they do? They interfere the physiological opening of the eustachian tube. So these three conditions, then we have any benign or malignant tumor. Of nasopharynx. Suppose for example, nasopharyngeal carcinoma. So any benign or malignant tumor of nasopharynx will lead to malfunctioning of eustachian tube. So it is, for example, we have nasopharyngeal carcinoma. So what is happening in nasopharyngeal carcinoma? The thing which you should remember about nasopharyngeal carcinoma is it is most common cause of unilateral secretory otitis media in adults. So nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Also another cause which may lead to malfunctioning of eustachian tube is any palatal defects like cleft palate or something like that. So first cause is malfunctioning of eustachian tube due to these four reasons. The second is any allergy or any allergens. What does these allergens do? They not only block the eustachian tube, but also it increase the secretory function of the mucus, of the middle ear mucosa. Third, we have viral infections. Any viral infection causing upper respiratory tract infection like adenovirus or rhinovirus. What they do? They increase the secretory function of the middle ear mucosa. So it lead to secretory otitis media. The third, last one is, that is the fourth, is unresolved otitis media. For example, Suppose we had a case of acute superative otitis media. So what we do in the treatment, we give the patient antibiotics. Suppose the patient has not completed the regime of the 14 days of antibiotics. He stopped, he feel comfortable, he thinks that he is fine and he didn't complete the course of the antibiotics. So what happens in this case, that the virus or the causative agent which caused the infection in the ear remains in the middle ear and it becomes inactive, but it is not completely resolved. So what happens in this case is there is a very low grade infection remaining in the middle ear, which leads to formation of secretory otitis media. So these were the causes. Now let's discuss the symptoms. So what are the symptoms of secretory otitis media? First we have hearing loss, conductive type of hearing loss. Usually this conductive type of hearing loss is painless and fluctuating. It is the most common symptom seen in of secretory otitis media. Other symptoms which we see are, first is defective or delayed speech, and the last is mild earache. Sometimes the patient may feel earache. So let's talk about the conductive type of hearing loss in this case. What is happening, the patient is, sometimes it is the only symptom present in the patient. So, but it is painless and fluctuating. So the patient is not careful, it is unidentified many times. And suppose the patient is going for a routine checkup in any, and it is detected accidentally. So it is the most common symptom, and mostly it is detected accidentally in many cases. Now let's talk about the signs. The tympanic membrane is dull and we can see and thin lesions of blood vessels are seen. At periphery. Suppose, I'll draw here. This is a tympanic membrane. What we see at the periphery? Lesions of blood vessels. Okay. Second thing, what are the sign? Which is a visible sign is the tympanic membrane is retracted. And its mobility is restricted. The third is the light reflex is lost of tympanic membrane. Last is the fluid level and air bubbles are visible in tympanic membrane. Suppose this is the tympanic membrane. So here we'll have the fluid level which will be visible. Here we have all the fluid and that is the normal part. So fluid level. And in this fluid we'll see some air bubbles. So air bubbles are seen. So these were the causes, symptoms and signs of the secretory otitis media. What we have discussed till now about the disease, its pathogenesis, its different names, Its causes, due to malfunctioning, allergens, viral infection. Its symptoms, which is conductive type of hearing loss, defective and delayed speech. We have seen mild earache and the signs. These are the things we have discussed till now. What we will discuss after this are the investigations and treatment. Are the investigations and treatment of the disease. So let's talk about the investigation. In investigation, we perform tuning fork test. What we will see in tuning fork test? Conductive type of hearing loss. We will go for audiometry. There also we will find that conductive type of hearing loss of ranging from 20 to 40 decibels. Then we have something called as, first we will discuss the X-ray. In X-ray what we will see? Clouding of mastoid air cells. After audiometry, we don't go for X-ray, we go for impedance audiometry. What is impedance audiometry? In impedance audiometry, we see type B curve. So let's discuss quickly about this impedance audiometry. What we do in impedance audiometry, we make a chart, or we can say we make a graph of, on the x-axis we take pressure changes, and on y-axis we take compliance of tympano-ossicular system, and we make a graph. So in this we have basically three type of curve. That is, first is A curve, which has a very high peak at the end. Let's take pressure changes on the axis, like minus 200. These are just an example of this chart. So this is called as A curve, which is the shifted towards the end and very high. Then we have a B curve. I'll take it as like this. And one more curve we have, that is a C curve. This is C curve. This is B curve. So such flat curve is seen in case of impedance audiometry. It is a chart made by comparing the pressure changes along with the compliance of tympano-ossicular system. So these are the investigation. Now let's discuss about the treatment. What is the ileum of, we have secretory otitis media, that is a fluid is there inside our middle ear. So what we aim during treatment, we aim at removing this fluid from the ear, and what we do, we try to treat the cause due to which this disease occurs. So in case of while discussing the treatment, there are two types. First, we can go for medical management. If it is not resolved in 3 to 6 months, we will go for surgical management. So in medical management, we'll give, first of all, we can go for decongestants. In decongestants, why we are giving decongestants? Because our middle, like our east stitching tube is edematous, it is swollen. So just to decrease its edema, we will give decongestant. We will go for antihistaminic or anti-allergens, antihistaminics. This we do if the cause is any allergen. If the disease is caused due to any allergens, we will go for antihistaminic. Third, we can give antibiotics. Suppose we have a case of antihistaminic is for allergens, decongestants to decrease the edema of Eustachian tube. Antibiotics. Antibiotics is given because if there can be a case of unresolved otitis media, in case of unresolved otitis media or upper respiratory tract infection. So in these two cases we give antibiotics. The last which we do is middle ear aeration. In this we use two techniques. First is Valsalva maneuver. And second is, if it is a child, we give him chewing gum. So why we are giving chewing gum to a child? That it will, he will continue keep on chewing it, and which will increase the swallowing and which will lead to opening of the eustachian tube. So now what is Valsalva maneuver? Valsalva maneuver is a technique which is used to just open the eustachian tube, sometimes if it is blocked. In this, what we do, we just tell the patient to close his or her lip tightly so that the mouth is closed. He is said to close his nose by these two fingers, and he is said to forcefully expire. And let's try it once. And when he is forcefully expiring, there is no way for the air to come out, not from nose, not from ear. So it tried to pass from the eustachian tube. When you will perform this, you will feel it in your both of the ears. So like this, you will close the lip, you will close the nose, and you will tell him to forcefully expire. Suddenly what happens, your face, your mouth is full of air, your nose is full of air. But if you will try to perform it, and then you will feel that something is coming out of your ear. So this is done in order to aerate the middle ear. Now, if using this pharmacological treatment or medical management, a patient is not recovering, he is not able to resolve the disease, then we will go for surgical management. In this, what we perform, the first thing which we perform is meningotomy. In this, what we do, we put an incision. Suppose this is a tympanic membrane. Tympanic membrane is divided into four quadrants. This is the posterior superior, this is the posterior inferior, this is the anterior superior, anterior inferior. So what we do, we put an incision in the anterior inferior compartment of the tympanic membrane, and we try to drain the fluid from there. In some cases, what is happening, there are the fluid is very thick and it is glue-like. In those cases, we have to perform We have to do two incisions. In that case, we use the anterior superior quadrant. So this is how we try to drain the fluid from surgery. If it is not working, you have inserted, you have done the incision, and still the patient is not able to resolve. So what we do? Second we do grommet insertion. So what is a grommet? It is nothing, it is like a tube. It is not a 3D diagram. So suppose it is a tube which has passage from two sides. What we do, we put a grommet inside the tympanic membrane and we keep it in the anterior inferior compartment. We put a grommet here and we keep it over there for a week or more than a month till the patient is completely treated. And the third which we can do is surgical treatment of cause. Suppose the cause of the secretory otitis media is adenoid hyperplasia or any or tonsillitis. So in this case, what we do? We will do adenoidectomy. Adenoidectomy or tonsillectomy. Just before myringotomy. So this were the treatment. We'll go for decongestion, antihistaminic, antibiotics, and middle ear aeration. If it is not helping or resolving within 3 to 6 months, we'll go for surgical management. In surgical, we will do myringotomy, that is incision. This is usually most commonly. But if it is a glue ear, like a glue-like secretion, so we will do 2 incisions here in the anterior superior or anterior inferior. If it is not resolved using myringotomy, we'll go for grommet insertion. This is a grommet. What we do, we put it in the anterior inferior compartment for a week or for a month or till when the patient is not completely treated. If the cause is like adenoid hyperplasia or tonsillitis, so what we do, we will do the surgical treatment of the cause, that is adenoidectomy or tonsillectomy. So once again, a short review of secretory otitis media. What it is? It is a non-purulent condition. It is a non-purulent effusion seen in the middle ear cavity. Then the causes are the main pathological cause are the malfunctioning of that eustachian tube, and the another one was increased secretory function of the mucosa. In symptoms, the most common symptom seen is painless and fluctuating conductive type of hearing loss. Then the signs which were visible were that above in the tympanic membrane that it was dull, the light reflex was absent, and we can see the fluid levels and air bubbles in it. Then the investigation in groaning in the tuning fork test, conductive type of hearing loss, audiometry 20 to 40 decibel of hearing loss, x-ray will see clouding of mastoid air cells, and in impedance we will see type B curve. Then the treatment is done using decongestant, antihistaminic, antibiotics, medical ear aeration, depending upon the cause. And we will treat, if it is untreated, we will go for surgery. So that was all about secretory otitis media. Thank you for watching. Please like, share and subscribe my channel, Meddy Simplified. Thank you.